So Sadiq, congratulations, man. Traveling all the way to Australia here in Adelaide. How's it feel to get the job done so quickly?
Yeah, it feels fantastic. Honestly, this is what I expected to happen. I trained for 15, 25-minute rounds, but I'm not surprised whenever it doesn't go that far.
I was going to say it's interesting because we had Kai Kara France here before, and he was talking about how sometimes when he goes through a fight, he doesn't go through adversity, it's almost weird for him because he had such a long lead-up and such a big training camp. Do you ever feel like that when your fights go so quickly?
No, I don't look a gift horse in the mouth. You know, if you was blessed, you take that blessing and you keep it moving.
Of course, I was going to say Suman sort of wasn't really happy with the stoppage. The internet sort of had a mixed reaction to, you know, the way it was stopped. What did you feel when you were in there, man?
That was inevitable. Come on, let's all be serious now. The way that was going, how many more punches would it have taken for it to stop? So the referee's doing his job. He got to look out for fighter safety. And he heard the referee telling them to defend themselves. I hit him with 6 more shots after the referee said, defend yourself, defend yourself, defend yourself. You got to make his job hard. You know, you gave him an easy decision. So he was like, I'll step in there and protect you.
It's been an emotional couple of weeks for you. Just talk to us. What was it like not only having to fight today, but also going through all the travel, getting all the way here and dealing with everything that's been going on?
It's been an emotional 2 weeks, you know. I've done some really unhealthy mental health stuff, which is bottling stuff up and, like, hiding it. I'm really into mental health. I read a lot of books about it. I know that's not good for me, but I had to do it. If any of you look on my social media, you'll see my mom comes to my gym, and I'm always pulling pranks on her and stuff like that at the gym. And the last video I did with her, she was only at the gym just showing face because my big brother was in a coma the whole time and there was hiding it from me. He got typhoid fever, and I'm sorry, I'm getting a little choked up, but she decided to not tell me. Like, they didn't tell me or my little brother, and he was in a coma, so she would just go home by herself and cry by herself. And that's the Saturday right before I came out here. My other brother in Nigeria called me. He said, hey, man, bro, I talked about it, passed away. And we just got hit from left field because me and my little brother didn't even know he was in a coma or he was sick or anything like that. My mom said she apologized right away because I kind of broke down. And she said, I just wanted you to focus on the fight. I didn't want it to get into your head. I wanted you to focus on the fight. Bro, I talked about it, would have wanted you to win this fight. You know, he wouldn't have wanted this to affect you. And I understand, man. My mom only did it out of love. You know, I love her and she knows that, but we don't keep secrets. So when I get home, I'm going to have to give her a little talking to, man. No matter how bad it is, we don't keep secrets. This fight would have been the fight no matter what.
So as you walk out to the octagon, how were you feeling today?
When I walked out to the octagon, I felt like another man. When I'm telling you, I locked this thing up and threw it in the back of my mind. That's all I've done. The only time I cried honestly about my big brother passing away was when workout got really hard. Like on the treadmill, my coach saw me crying because I just couldn't hold it in. Because when you have physical exhaustion, then the mental stuff comes in. And that was the only time I really had to cry about it. Outside of that, I haven't even cried about it. So right now, you see how I'm like chilling. This is not right. You know, I'm going to face it. When I get home, I'm going to confront it. I haven't even looked at his pictures. I haven't looked at his social media. Whenever I see people writing rest in peace from my family, I like blocked it and like I didn't even look at it. I haven't looked at our last messages or anything like that. I'm going to go home and spend some time to really grieve. But I wanted to say something to the octagon. I had to dedicate it to him. I was like, no matter what, I'm going to say something over there. And hopefully I don't cry and look like a little sissy on TV.
I definitely don't think you would look like a sissy either way. It's pretty crazy that you have the mental strength to sort of put that to the side. I was going to say, as far as your next fight goes, do you think you might need a little bit of time to sort of dedicate it to your family? Like, I imagine you're probably not really thinking about fighting right now.
Yeah, I've gotten a couple other interviews before this. Like I said, when I dialed into the fight, like I haven't thought about who I'm going to fight next, training or anything. I didn't even think about what's going to happen on December 3rd. All I thought about was December 1st, December 2nd. And that's it. So the next step right now is to go hang out with my mom. I want to be with my mom and my brother.
On a more sort of positive note, you coined the term Blaxplosive. When did that sort of come to you?
Oh, yeah. No, my boy Jack Slack, man. Jack Slack always talks about Blaxplosive. A lot of people shy away from it, you know, because they tend to seem like it's some type of like racism or something like that. I'll be perfectly honest with you. I know what I bring to the table. I'm African as a mug, and I bring some explosive power in there. I tell you, I'm Nigel O'Day. You got to rep your set. I bring some explosiveness in there, and then I just support that with clean technique. You know, I'm black explosive. I'll claim that all day.
What do you think about this Nigerian takeover that we're seeing?
It's an African takeover, man.
It's all coming at the same time, yeah. You got Usman, you got Israel as well.
Yeah, man, we're coming, man. The African wave is about to hit the shore. We're all coming little by little. And I think the UFC just did something with South Africa or something like that. Sooner or later, we're going to host one back home, and that's going to be a blessing, man. We're just leading the way for our people. Israel and Kamaru are like the big brothers there, and I'm just following along, and we're going to build this house.
When it comes to your career, you've had an incredible year. You did the Contender Series, had an incredible performance, now win here on the other side of the world in Adelaide. When you look back at the craziness that's happened in this UFC run, how do you sort of look back on 2018?
2018 was meant to be, you know, it was meant to be. 2018, it started off a little bit rough. Honestly, I got a personal invite to do the Ultimate Fighter, the season that Suman was in. I turned it down, and then I lost, my first loss of my career. And if you guys go watch the fight, it was a fight that I was dominating, and I got a bit careless. But that fight was a blessing, because after I lost that fight, I got real deep into my mental health stuff, like just focusing on the mental parts of training. I got the physical stuff all day. I'm African, so I got to focus on the mental side. And when I started focusing on is being locked in, staying in the fight. No matter what happens, no matter how good it goes or how bad it goes, you gotta keep doing your job. And it was a blessing. Unfortunately, I didn't get to go into Ultimate Fighter season, but as soon as I lost that one, I won another one and I got invited into the Contender. And the people in the Contender, I guess they just looked at that loss and didn't look at how the fight went or how all my previous fights had looked. So they had me as a 3-1 underdog, not knowing what they had their hands on, you know. But now I'm pretty sure everybody knows. After I get that 50 G's too, it's going to feel awesome.
Anybody confirm that to you, that you'll be getting the 50 G's?
Nah, man, you got to speak this thing into the world. I told you. I'm super into that stuff. You got to speak it into existence, man. I hope I get it. There's been a lot of decisions tonight, and the fight that's happening right now looks like it's going to go into decision too. Now I just got to go shoot the little heavyweights in the leg, and hopefully they don't knock each other out. I might hit him. What's the name of that Olympian that got her leg broken backstage? That's what I'm going to do with every single one of the main event, co-main event, and the one after that, so they could have a nice and boring fight.
Poor Shogun Hunt, Taito Vasa.
They better keep their head on the swivel.
As we let you go, have you had a chance to speak to your mom? I imagine you would have got. You'll be getting on the phone with her.
As soon as I finish this fight, I came right to doing media. I'm gonna talk to her, but she knows she's in a little bit of trouble. I'm gonna let her have it. All with love though, but I'm gonna let her have it. Maybe I might just wait until I see her face to face, just to get a little bit of payback. But I know she loves me, man. I love you too, Mom.
Great. Well, congratulations. Thank you so much.
Thank you.